Here is an image of a shape that I'm sure you all immediately recognized as a hexagon due to the six sides and six vertices. But if I were to show this image to a chemist, they wouldn't call it a hexagon. They would say that this is cyclohexane, a chemical compound made up of carbon and hydrogen atoms. The hexagon is a shorthand used in chemistry to simplify drawings of molecules. This is just one example of how someone with expertise in a discipline perceives the world differently than someone outside of that discipline. In fact, this difference in perception happens all the time. When we take in information, it becomes filtered through our own lens, altered by our unique perspectives and experiences, which impacts how we interpret them. Take a moment to imagine a scientist. You probably picture someone who is smart, who can recite facts about niche science topics. But that is an oversimplification. Scientists experience years of training to become experts in their field. They conduct independent research using the scientific method, and in doing so, develop specific disciplinary knowledge. But underlying all that knowledge is how scientists think. And that thinking process is distinct from that of a novice. In a study published in the journal Cognitive Science, researchers provided novice and expert physicists with pairs of fundamental physics problems, such as calculating the acceleration of a ball rolling down an inclined plane. The researchers asked them to categorize the problems in terms of the type of solution. In their responses, the novice focused on surface-level similarities, whereas the experts described the problems in terms of theories and working principles of physics. The process of becoming a scientist is not just about learning content. It is about developing a new way of thinking. In higher education, students must undergo a transformation to gain that expertise. When you picture a college science classroom, what do you see? My bet is you probably imagined a large lecture hall with tiered seating. The room is filled with hundreds of students, and at the front of the room is the instructor. As the instructor begins to speak, students eagerly listen and rapidly take notes. This is what college teaching universally looked like in the past, and to some extent continues to look like today. But this is beginning to change. Students are not passive observers. Instead, they are active participants. They spend class time individually thinking, working with their peers on problem solving, and engaging in classroom discussions. The reason for this shift is because research in education has demonstrated that content transmission by lecturing is a less effective way to teach. Consider teaching someone how to bake a cake. They're going to learn more effectively if they have the chance to work with the ingredients, in comparison to listening to someone read aloud a recipe. Active learning, the process of engaging with the material itself, is an evidence-based teaching approach shown to improve student learning. Instructors who thoughtfully build in opportunities to problem solve and have classroom conversations are helping students to deepen their understanding. Rather than simply being able to recall cake ingredients, they are empowering their students to understand the purpose of each ingredient, positioning them to critically evaluate new recipes, or perhaps even create their own. Fortunately, universities have begun to recognize that instructors who are trained as scientists should also receive formal teacher training to be able to create these types of learning environments. Take, for example, physicist and educationist Carl Wieman. He demonstrated that some of the most challenging skills for students to master surround metacognitive practices. Metacognition is the ability to think about your own thinking, where students identify their weaknesses and then take action to fill in gaps in their own knowledge. And this skill has a profound impact on learning. By acknowledging that this is a learning challenge, instructors can proactively plan their lectures to help students develop this skill. Research such as this demonstrates that it is critical for instructors to understand how students learn. Effective teaching begins by embracing the perspective of a novice. But what about those who do not pursue a degree in science? I acknowledge that the majority of our population are not looking to become scientific experts, but scientific literacy should be accessible to everyone, particularly because we are bombarded with new information that has the capacity to greatly impact our world. Science communicators work exceptionally hard to break down science to the public. Yet, there continues to be a chasm between scientific information and public comprehension, a phenomenon called the backfire effect, initially described by Brendan Nyhan, demonstrates how sharing facts about science in an attempt to quell misinformation does not help to change people's minds or provide education, but instead it paradoxically pushes folks towards their initial beliefs. How can we bridge the gap between scientists and the general public? Scientists can implement teaching strategies to effectively communicate with the perspective of non-scientists in mind. Lead with empathy. College students navigate many stressors as they progress through their degree. Instructors who teach from a student-centered philosophy cultivate a classroom environment that is compassionate of the needs of students. They take steps to minimize school stress by removing unnecessary or arbitrary challenges, allowing students to reach their highest potential. All of this begins with empathy. Research has shown that instructors who cognitively and effectively empathize with their students can improve students' experiences in the classroom. Empathy is not just a personality trait. It is an integral part of the role of a teacher. Science tends to be very task-driven in pursuit of results. But when it comes to communicating that science to a non-specialized audience, the audience should be prioritized in the same way that an instructor prioritizes the needs of their students. When there is a lack of empathy and an unwillingness to see an alternative point of view, it risks being interpreted as scientific elitism and perpetuates the stereotype that scientists are cold and detached. By approaching conversations with an empathetic mindset, scientists may more readily recognize that most people are trying to do the best with the information they have. This builds trust and creates space to ask questions. This is a type of formative assessment, a method educators use to assess students' knowledge in a low-stakes manner. It provides students with the opportunity to self-evaluate and allows instructors to get a sense of where students are struggling and determine how to provide adequate support. Recently, in a second-year chemistry course, I asked my students to complete a survey where I included first-year chemistry questions. I used the results of the survey to determine what review material we needed to cover. Not all students are starting from the same point, and as an instructor, it is necessary to figure out what that starting point is. Communicating science should begin with a similar approach. If scientists lead with information, they're making assumptions about someone's level of knowledge. Instead, they should ask open-ended questions, such as, "What do you know about that topic?" By cultivating curiosity, scientists can begin to understand the perspective of a non-scientist and meet them where they're at. To share information, scientists should facilitate a dialogue. A dialogic classroom is one where students can interact with the instructor and with one another. For example, a flipped classroom is an instructional model where students watch pre-recorded video content before class, and then during class, they work through challenging problems with their peers and with the support of the instructor. This is successful when students are encouraged to share their ideas and their opinions, and the instructor is accepting of those perspectives. The same goes for science itself. Science is not a solitary pursuit, but a social one, where generating scientific knowledge is strengthened by incorporating new, diverse perspectives. Consider thought-terminating clichés. These are short phrases that are meant to end a discussion, such as, "You just need to do your own research," or, "That is just your opinion." When they are used in scientific discourse, they are unproductive and dismissive. scientists should not have the only voice in the conversation. Instead, when they are open-minded to new ideas, they can facilitate a productive discussion, incorporate multiple viewpoints, and ultimately, more learning can occur. But these three actions only address one half of the science communication problem. Non-scientists can learn to approach scientific information with the mindset of a scientist. Identify the source. Scientific information can be found in academic journals, textbooks, websites, or even word of mouth. Have you ever heard someone begin a sentence with, "Well, they say that"? Who is they? Where did you actually hear this information? Scientists, as a part of their training, are adept at identifying and evaluating the reliability of sources. They tend to be skeptical about where information originates and favor information published in scholarly sources. This includes scientific journals, where the articles are written by scientists in the field and they've undergone the rigorous peer review process. This is a process where other experts review the article and provide recommendations prior to publication. While it's not a perfect system, it provides validity to scientific research. But scholarly sources are used to primarily facilitate communication between experts rather than to the public. Instead, popular information sources are used to provide information to the public, such as websites, television, and social media. Since these are second or third-hand accounts of the original source, it is particularly important to be critical of the information and seek out the original source. It is easy to believe a headline that confirms a bias we already hold, but with a bit of skepticism, non-scientists can assess the source prior to clicking share. From there, it is equally as important to evaluate the evidence. Anecdotal evidence is derived from personal and secondhand experiences and can commonly elicit strong emotional reactions. While anecdotes can be useful to formulate research questions and initiate further investigations, they can also be used to spread misinformation and manipulate an audience. Scientists are careful not to misrepresent or rely on anecdotes when describing scientific findings. Instead, they defer to empirical evidence, which is data gathered using the scientific method. The process of testing hypotheses through carefully designed experiments provides rigor and reliability to a data set. It is particularly important to distinguish between forms of evidence because someone with an advanced degree can cherry-pick a study that supports their claim. If the individual is believed solely on account of their credentials, yet a significant amount of empirical evidence that contradicts them is ignored, it becomes an appeal to authority fallacy. By adopting a data-driven mindset, non-scientists can begin to notice the quantity and quality of empirical evidence in favor of a particular claim. But what about when the evidence is challenging to understand? Recognize the limits of your knowledge. PhD-trained scientists spend years studying a specific topic to become an expert in that specific field. I have several friends who also have a PhD in chemistry, yet it would take a significant amount of my effort to deeply understand the content of their PhD theses. This is because our areas of expertise are incredibly specialized. The more you know, the less you understand is how the saying goes. But this type of recognition is really valuable. I notice that when I'm asked a scientific question by a non-scientist, I take a moment to reflect on my knowledge. Is this something I can readily answer due to my expertise? Do I need to do more learning before attempting to answer their question? Or is this a case where I need to recommend a scientist with more specialized knowledge on the topic? The Dunning-Kruger effect occurs when this element of self-reflection is missing. It describes how individuals with lower competence in a particular subject matter often overestimate their competence. This is not to say that non-scientists should avoid all conversations outside of their area of knowledge, but instead to disclose their certainty on the topic. By taking a moment to step back and reflect, Non-scientists can decide on whether they need more information to understand the science before taking action. Effective science communication is a challenging task, and the backfire effect is one manifestation of that challenge. Sharing facts discounts the training that educators receive to effectively communicate ideas to their students, and it neglects the underlying thinking skills that scientists have developed. Scientists should communicate with empathy, curiosity, and an open mind, while non-scientists should adopt a skeptical, data-driven, and reflective mindset when encountering scientific information. By emulating the thinking skills that science educators teach and how they teach them, together we can improve how scientific information is explained and understood. Not everyone needs to receive a formal science education, but we can still learn from those who provide one. So the next time you see a hexagon, I don't expect you to recognize cyclohexane, but I do hope it reminds you of how we can all learn from one another's valuable and unique perspectives.